Hey guys, good evening. I hope I'm visible and audible to you all. Give me a quick confirmation in the live chat if I am, and there's no audio visual lag that we face very often. If everything is good, we'll begin with GU and gyne-onc radiology that we want to discuss today. My name is Zainab Vora, and I have done my MBBS and MD in radiology from AIIMS New Delhi, and today we shall look at, as I said, genitourinary and gyne-onc imaging. So, is the audio visual good, guys? Give me a quick confirmation of that, and I will check out your comments. And
quick confirmation of that.
Yeah, I think it seems good from my end. All right, okay, amazing. So let's begin then. You guys know about Unacademy. So it's the largest learning platform that we have, which is also having a lot of recent new updates that you guys will soon be getting to know about. And you can also combine it with PrepLadder, which is also available for recorded lecture, so you can make the best of both the worlds. And on Sunday, we are coming up with this emergency series that you guys know about. And also, Unacademy has a lot of offers going on for plus subscription. So those of you who are looking to subscribe, now is the best time to do that. And the various batch courses which are ongoing at the moment are for various exams like the NEET PG, NEXT 2022, as well as FMG aspirants. And you also have a grand test which is coming up for the FMG students on 11th of June. Alright, so definitely check that out. And if you want to subscribe to anything, you can use my code, which is ZURALIFE, in order to do so, or just ZURA will also do. Okay, so let's begin very quickly with obstetric ultrasound and early pregnancy ultrasound. Alright, so I'm showing you a series of images here which depict the sequence of events that a fetus or an embryo will undergo on the ultrasound. Alright, so what are the changes from the earliest change to the final definitive change that, all right, it's a live intrauterine pregnancy that we see, and you get a lot of questions from these, right, as you might be knowing. So the first thing, when I ask you, when we have two ultrasounds up our sleeve, right, when you want to look into the uterus, I can either do a transvaginal sonogram or a transabdominal sonogram. All right, so which one will show the findings earlier? So quite logically, because TVS has a higher resolution, we are going near the uterus, TVS is basically going to show us the findings much earlier by a period of 1 week. Alright, so by a period of 1 week, it's going to precede the findings on TS. Alright, so here we can just write when this finding will be seen on TVS and TAS, and it's quite clear that you just pretty much add 1 week and you don't have to remember this line. Correct. So that is alright. So we'll only remember the findings on TVS. So what is the earliest finding? If I have a one-liner that will ask me what is the earliest finding of intrauterine pregnancy, what is your answer? It is this structure, it's this tiny little sac of fluid, which is nothing but the gestational sac that I call as G-sac. So this is the earliest finding that we see at 4 weeks plus 5 days on TVS. So this is the earliest G-sac that I get to know that, okay, this might be pregnancy. But am I sure, guys? Am I sure that this is definitely intrauterine pregnancy? Not yet. This could also be a pseudo-gestational sac. But usually a pseudo-gestational sac will be slightly irregular. It won't be, first of all, very, very eccentric. All right, so there are two features that we will have which tell us that it's likely to be a true gestational sac. One, it is eccentrically placed in the endometrium. All right, so it will be eccentrically placed. Second, we have one more sign that it develops, which is called as double decidual sign. So it develops a double decidual sign, and the fact that it is eccentric is called what? It's also called as intradecidual sign. So there are two signs which tell us that this is not a pseudo G-sac, this is a true G-sac. Alright, so this I will see at 4 weeks plus 5 days. Yeah, this is the first slide, just started. Then, what happens next? So this was going on at 4 weeks plus 5 days. Then, slowly, slowly within this G-sac, do you see this? That this is the G-sac, within the G-sac, now something else has happened. Something else has happened, which is this structure. What is this? So now, a yolk sac has developed, right? So a yolk sac has developed here. So the yolk sac is the What is the one-liner for the yolk sac? So the one-liner, the most important finding is, abhi tak we were not pretty sure that is it really the G-sac? We had these signs to tell us that it's likely a true sac, but now we can confirm. So this is a confirmatory sign that it is indeed intrauterine pregnancy and it is not a pseudo G-sac. All right, it's not a pseudo gestational sac. So this ring within the sac is the yolk sac which confirms. When do you see it? So this was 4 weeks plus 5 days. You keep adding one week. Right, so now it becomes 5 weeks plus 5 days. All right, so 5 to 6 weeks you will see. All right, so you can say 5 weeks to 6 weeks the yolk sac develops. Slowly, what happens? Now see this, so this outer one, G-sac, this ring, yolk sac, and now who has started to appear. So this is our baby, this is our fetus, this is our embryo, right? The correct phrase would be embryo at this point. So now the embryo develops. So when does it develop? 5 weeks plus 5 days pe the, 5 to 6 weeks. So can I say 6 weeks to 7 weeks? The embryo shows up, right? And within a day or two. So from 7 to 7.5 weeks, what we will have is a fetal heart rate that will start to appear. So the fetal heart rate starts to appear at this point. And can I say once I hear the fetal heart rate or I see the fetal heart rate, this is confirmation of viability of pregnancy. That this is a viable, this is a live embryo that I am seeing. Alright, so this is the sequence. So embryo came, then heart came. And now what is happening? So this is the embryo which has grown pretty much and it is also forming one more sac around it. What is this sac which is now showing up? This is the amnion. This is the amnion which is coming. And see this embryo now. In fact, at around 8 to 8.5 weeks, all right, at around 8 to 9 weeks, I can see the various developing organs also. So can you make out here in this embryo, which could be the cranial end, which could be the caudal end? Does it make sense to you that this is likely the developing brain? So this is the rhombencephalon that you are seeing. This is the cranial end and these are the limb buds. These are the limb buds that the baby is developing. Can you see chota chota upper limb, lower limb, everything is starting to come, right? So this is the caudal end. So if I want to measure the gestational age, do you agree I can measure this crown to rump length? So this length of the fetus or the embryo to be precise is going to be the crown to rump length. And the importance of this crown to rump length is what? The importance is that this is the most accurate feature which will tell me that this is the gestational age. If they ask you, ki kaun sa parameter hai which is the most accurate marker of gestational age, it's going to be crown rump length. Alright, is this clear everybody? So this is the sequence of events. Now just to tell you a few signs that we frequently confuse. Alright, so one that I told you, intradecidual sign. Second, double decidual sign, isn't it? And the third one is double bleb sign. So there are three signs which we have, which we frequently tend to confuse. So intradecidual sign just tells you that the G-sac is going to develop eccentrically within the endometrial canal. This is the earliest sign. Alright, so this is the earliest sign of pregnancy if they ask you. Following this, what's going to happen, guys? Following this, the two layers of decidua. Which two layers? CP. Again, CP comes to our rescue like it does a lot of times, right? Connaught Place is our favorite mnemonic. So here also we have CP, wherein the capsularis and the parietalis are two layers of decidua which are separated by this thin stripe of fluid. So this is called as double decidual sign. Ye dono hi signs depict a gestational sac, right? So these are for marking a G-sac from a pseudo sac. Is this clear? And what is double bleb? This is a previous year question. So double bleb mein jo do blebs hai, what are those? One of them, do you see, has an embryo attached to it? Do you see this ki iske paas ek embryo hai? So the one sac which has embryo is gonna be what? So this embryo is gonna be basically, so this sac is gonna be the amnion. This is the embryo here and this sac here is our yolk sac, is our yolk sac. Alright, so this is basically the double bleb sign. Somebody asked, double decidual appears at what time? So when our G-sac was appearing, right? So this is going to appear at around 4 weeks to 5 days. Alright, so 4 weeks plus 5 days to 5 weeks. Alright, so this range may on a TVS, we will see this. Is this clear, everybody? So these are the various signs of early pregnancy, which are very important. You learn them in gyne ops also, but just get them done with right now. Okay, everybody? So G-sac, uske baad yolk sac, uske baad embryo, uske baad fetal heart rate, and then you have the amnion which is coming. And this is the sequence which takes place from 4 weeks to 9 weeks when our baby is growing. Okay, so now going on 2, some more features. So fetal heart rate, remember we saw it will be seen somewhere around 6 to 6.5 weeks on TVS. And this is how we measure. So now tell me, what is this mode of ultrasound that we are using to measure the fetal heart rate? This mode of ultrasound is called the M mode. Anytime you see these lines, we know for pneumothorax also we use these lines. This is the M mode of ultrasound, right? So this is M mode ultrasound that is used for measurement of fetal heart rate. Okay. And two features, two important numbers I want you to remember as far as early demise is concerned. All right. So when we talk about early pregnancy failure, all right, or early intrauterine demise, there are two numbers. So when you have a CRL, you have an embryo which has developed. The embryo has also grown to 7 millimeter size, but the fetal heart rate has still not appeared. Is that a good sign or a bad sign? That's a bad sign. The fetus is 7 millimeters. It's pretty much grown, but the fetal heart rate is not present. That tells you that what is happening, that the fetus is likely not viable. Right? So there is, that becomes a sign of early pregnancy failure. And what is the technical term? So gynae. So although now the preferred terminology is early pregnancy failure, but the older terminology that was used for this is called missed abortion. Right? So this is referred to as missed abortion when embryo is 7, but the fetal heart rate is not there. And one more number that I also want you to remember here is when the GSAC becomes very large. How large? When the GSAC becomes more than 25 millimeters, but there are no signs of embryo. Embryo is still not shown up. GSAC is ready, it's growing, but no embryo. What is this called? Very nice. So this, as you are all correctly saying, is called blighted ovum. Alright, so now for both of these conditions, the preferred term is early pregnancy failure. But in your exam, you might get these terms. So remember, two numbers, 7 mm, 25 mm. Alright, theek hai? It's going to be difficult, Ashish, but do we have a choice? We are in the middle of a pandemic, so extraordinary circumstances call for extraordinary things. So you guys are an extraordinary batch who have to go through this, but you are not going to be alone who's going to be sitting with the mask on, right? It's going to be everybody who's going to be with the mask on. So it's kind of an equalizer. It's not a good equalizer. It's not the ideal condition to give the exam, but the exam had to happen somewhere, right? So it had to happen sometime. It's happening now and we have to live with it, right? So the sooner we accept the reality, the better it will be. Rather than questioning everything, we just accept and we move on. That will be my advice. I know it's not what you are looking for, but that is what it is. Okay, anyway, so after that, let's look at this condition. So what we are seeing, again, a transvaginal sonogram. So this is the uterus. What has happened? This person comes to you saying that my beta HCG is raised, my urine pregnancy test is positive. What are we seeing? This is the endometrium. Is there any GSAC here, guys? Is there any sac here? There is no sac in the endometrium. What are we seeing here? But somewhere outside, I am seeing that a pregnancy is developing, which is not intrauterine. So when you see a pregnancy which is developing near the tube, near the adnexa, this is ectopic pregnancy. This is ectopic pregnancy. And when you put on a Doppler, when you put on a Doppler box, you would see that it has a lot of peripheral vascularity. That is referred to as a ring of fire sign. So a ring of fire sign is seen on a Doppler ultrasound. Okay, so this is something which is how you will see in ectopic, where the endometrium would be empty. All right. Okay, what about this? So now let's discuss all the features of Downs. Alright, so this is something that again we get tested a lot. What are the ultrasound soft markers which tell us that the baby might have Downs syndrome or aneuploidy? So first question to you, which is the marker which has the highest likelihood ratio or the highest pretest odds that the baby has Downs, which is the one with the highest likelihood ratio? So the answer to that will be, which trimester are you asking? Are you asking me for the first trimester or the second trimester? Remember, all of these soft markers of Down syndrome, which trimester will I be seeing them? Would it be the first trimester or the second trimester? Tell me, guys. Do I see all of these features of the organs, the soft tissue markers in the first trimester? No, I see it in the second trimester ultrasound. And most of you told me as the strongest likelihood ratio for nuchal translucency being increased. Tell me, Which trimester do I measure the nuchal translucency? When do I do the NTNB scan? The NTNB scan is done in the first trimester, 11 to 13 plus 6 weeks. So, can I measure nuchal translucency in the second trimester? No, I can't. So, what is the counterpart of nuchal translucency that we measure in the second trimester? It is this measurement that we are taking here. This is called as nuchal fold thickness, NFT. So, nuchal fold thickness, remember, has the highest likelihood ratio of the soft tissue markers of Down syndrome. Is this clear? What is the difference? Why are we saying that nuchal translucency, nuchal fold, both are neck, right? Both are neck. So, in the first trimester, what we will see on a sagittal plane, in the mid-sagittal plane, that behind the neck of the baby, there is this collection of fluid. When this collection of fluid, which is translucent, anechoic, translucent, becomes increased. Again, we have age-wise numbers, but for our exam, what is the number that we can remember? The number we can remember is 3 millimeters. If NT is more than 3 mm, abnormal. And in the second trimester, see how I'm measuring nuchal fold. This was mid-sag. Here, I am measuring in an axial section. This is an axial section. Do you see the circumference of the bone here? So, this is the bone here. This is the calvarium. We are near the posterior fossa where this is the cerebellum. And behind the cerebellum, this is the neck. So, we have taken an axial section here. All right. So, this is an axial section that we have taken. And this thickness would be more than 6 mm if it is abnormal. So, remember the difference between NFT and NT. NFT is the one which we measure in the second trimester. Got it, everybody? So, this is about NFT being the strongest marker. What are the other features? So, in the brain, what else can we have in the brain? These are the two ventricles with echogenic choroid plexus. Is ventriculomegaly also a soft marker? Answer is yes. So, ventriculomegaly also a soft marker. What am I seeing here? This is again a mid-sagittal section. What is absent here? What is it that all of us have but this baby doesn't have? Do you see how all the bones appear white? This is the palate which appears white. But here, do you see any white nasal bone? Yahan pe ek nasal bone hona chahiye tha, that is absent. So again, I can see nasal bone hypoplasia or I can see nasal bone absence also as a soft tissue marker. Alright. Apart from that, what else can I see? In the fingers, what do I expect, guys? In the fingers, what is it called? It is called clinodactyly. Right? So, we can also see clinodactyly, which would be a soft tissue marker. Apart from that, see this sagittal image. This is the spine of the baby. Look at the bowel. The bowel is quite echogenic. Don't you agree? Echogenic bowel, is that also a sign? Answer is yes. So, echogenic bowel, also a soft tissue marker. Along with echogenic only. Remember one more thing. Echogenic ke saath mein, can there be something in the heart which is echogenic? Do you see this? Can you imagine this is the heart? Dikh raha hai sabko. So this is basically the fourth chamber view of the heart. Alright. And do you see one white dot within the heart? So this is called as echogenic intracardiac focus. Alright. Now don't worry ki aapko exam mein ye image denge and they'll ask you to identify this. No. It will be very difficult for you to identify, but you need to know the list. I am just showing you the images so that you remember and understand better. Okay, so wo puchenge nahi, batao ye kya hai. Alright, so you must know the list. All of these are soft markers of Downs except, but they will not ask you to identify like I am asking you. Okay, apart from that, what else are you seeing? What else can you see here? In this, can you see these two bubbles? Can you see these two bubbles of air here? Alright, although it's filled with fluid right now because it's a fetus, this is a double bubble sign. So, you can also see a double bubble sign because of duodenal atresia in Down syndrome. Plus, what is it that we are seeing here? What is it that we are seeing? This is called a sandal gap. This is a sandal gap that you are again seeing. And you will notice that the short bones are again basically noted here. All right. So diffusely, you will have a short femur, a short humerus. Again, all of these are soft markers. Apart from that, you can also get pyelectasis. What is pyelectasis? The pelvis is dilated. Fine. So all of these are soft tissue markers. Highest likelihood ratio will be asked. Nuchal fold thickness. Second, ventriculomegaly. Third, nasal bone hypoplasia or absence. Third, echogenic bowel, sandal gap, clinodactyly, short bones, pyelectasis, double bubble sign, echogenic intracardiac focus. फोकस. ठीक है, तो पूरा लिस्ट याद नहीं रखना. इफ एनीथिंग अपार्ट फ्रॉम दिस लिस्ट कम्स, यू नीड टू आइडेंटिफाई बेसिकली. ऑल एक्सेप्ट टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चन माइट कम फ्रॉम दिस. फाइन, सो दिस इज अबाउट ऑल द सॉफ्ट मार्कर्स ऑफ डाउन सिंड्रोम. गोइंग अहेड, सो दिस इज द लिस्ट अगेन फॉर यू दैट आई हैव प्रोवाइडेड. सी हियर, इंक्रीज न्यूकल फोल्ड थिकनेस, हाइएस्ट लाइवलीहुड रेशियो. देन द सेकेंड ऑन द लिस्ट वुड बी नेजल बोन हाइपोप्लेशिया, एंड देन यू हैव अदर्स. ऑलराइट, ऑलराइट, नो, ऑल नीड नॉट बी प्रेजेंट. यू कैन ईदर हैव वन or more. All right, so you can have one or more. The more the number of markers, the higher is your risk. But even if you have one, you would want to send the patient for confirmation. Pylectasis means the dilatation of pelvis. All right, Guntas, it means that the pelvis is dilated. So anything which is more than 4 mm before 33 weeks or 7 mm after 33 weeks tells you that the renal pelvis is dilated. All right, so that is pylectasis. Okay, right. So now, again, very, very important, twins. So very quickly, let's identify these three types of twins. Which is the easiest one? Which is this kind of twin, jinke beech mein koi diwari nahi hai. There's nothing separating them. So when you have nothing separating them, what does it mean? Do they have any amniotic sac? No. So can I just say that this is MAMC, right? So this is monoamniotic, monochorionic, right? So this is the easiest one where there's nothing separating the two babies. All right. Now, in both of these, I have a membrane. So can I just write that both of these are going to be diamniotic? That is for sure that dono hi diamniotic hai because of this membrane. Now I have to figure which is dichorionic, which is monochorionic. So for that, what are we going to see? We are going to see the placental attachment. Look at this placental attachment and see how wide it becomes, right? So this tells you what? That there is chorion which is going into the membrane. There are two different chorions which are supplying. Right, so this is your DADC, diamniotic, dichorionic. Plus, what is the thickness of the intertwin membrane? Intertwin membrane ka thickness will be more than 2 mm. What is this sign called? This is called the twin peak sign or the lambda sign. Correct. And what do you see here? An intertwin membrane which is very, very thin inserts perpendicularly like a T. So this is your T sign seen with monochorionic diamniotic. So these are your three kinds of twins. Is this easy? And this comes every time. All right. So this comes every time. So this is a sure short question. None of you is getting wrong. All right. Is that for sure? Is that a done deal, everybody? So ye galat nahi karna kyunki ye aa raha hai. All right. So this is DADC, MCD and MAMC. All right. So now going ahead to a few more ultrasound anomalies on the OBS ultrasound. A few named signs that I want you guys to know. This is again the favorite of all you guys. You guys love the two fruits which we have in the brain of abnormal babies. What is this fruit that I am showing you here, or fruit or vegetable? Yeah, so this is lemon sign. This is the lemon sign wherein we are seeing that in the bifrontal areas. All right, so in the bifrontal areas, you are having this bony indentation. As a bone indent ho raha hai. So this is referred to as the lemon sign, and it's typically associated with a Chiari malformation, right? Typically, we are taught ki spina bifida, but remember, Chiari malformation would be a better answer. Chiari 2, Chiari 1, both of them can show Chiari 2 more than Chiari 1. Alright, so this is lemon sign. Right, what about this? This we had seen in the NeuroRadwala class, if you guys were there. The MRI counterpart of it. Now, I will, we'll get the annotated PDF also on the group. If you are fine with the dirtiness of the annotations, then I'll just post it. So, what are we seeing here? This is your Dandy Walker. Remember when we have a posterior fossa, so this is the cerebellum on one side, this is the cerebellum on two sides. In our banana sign, basically what we will see is that this is the cerebellum which appears like a banana. Here the banana is broken. Do you see this? Ki banana ke beech mein there is a break. So what happened? What is it that is agenetic? So the vermis never formed. So the two cerebellar hemispheres are on their own, right? So the vermis never formed. There is vermian agenesis. What else? What are you seeing in the posterior fossa, guys? In the posterior fossa, is there something black? What is black on ultrasound? Please remind me, what is anechoic on ultrasound? It's fluid. So can I say there is a posterior fossa cyst which is making the posterior fossa enlarged? So when I see this, and this posterior fossa cyst is communicating with the fourth ventricle. So now, what is this cluster? This is a Dandy Walker malformation. So this is how Dandy Walker malformation will appear. Very important. So now, are you guys clear with how it will appear on MR and how it will appear on an antenatal ultrasound? It can be picked up on the antenatal ultrasound itself. Alright? Okay. What about this, where you have a single thalamus and a single brain, a monoventricle, a single ventricle, two ventricles are fused into one. So this is called as pancake brain, right? So this is referred to as pancake brain, which we see with, yes, that we see with holoprosencephaly, right? That we see with holoprosencephaly, all right? So this is pancake brain associated with Patau's syndrome. And what about this? Again, the favorite of examiners, this you have to get correct in your exam. When you see the eyes protruding out like this, the brain is very malformed that you are seeing. This is suggestive of anencephaly, right? So this is suggestive of anencephaly that you are seeing, and it's a spectrum. So what is the spectrum? It's an acrania, exencephaly, anencephaly spectrum. So what is acrania? Acrania is absence of skull bone. So when there is no skull bone, do you agree that the brain matter is going to be exposed to the amniotic fluid? When it's exposed to the amniotic fluid, exencephaly, it's outside. What will happen? Slowly, it'll start to degenerate. Do you agree? So the brain matter that you are seeing here also, residual brain matter, starts to degenerate, and eventually you will have no brain left, which is anencephaly. So to be precise, what should I call this? Should I call this exencephaly? Yes, so this is actually exencephaly, and even when this thing disappears, it will be anencephaly. Alright, but yeah, as you are all correctly giving me all the one-liners, is the earliest anomaly that can be picked up in the first trimester scan. Alright, apart from that, frog eyes, what else? Mickey Mouse, all of these are quite insensitive names which have been given to this condition. Alright, so these are various anomalies that you need to know. Now, changing gears completely from pregnancy scans to genitourinary. Alright, so genitourinary, what are we talking about? So, I'm showing you three images. Can you tell me what is the diagnosis based on these three images? Very, very important. A young male came to me with a lot of pain in the flanks. So, what we are seeing here is, first, this is an ultrasound image. On the ultrasound image, you can see that there's a hyperechoic structure, and the hyperechoic structure is producing posterior acoustic shadowing, isn't it? Anytime I see such a description, a hyperechoic structure producing posterior acoustic shadowing, I know it's a calculus. But kahan ka calculus? Renal calculus, GB calculus, for that I have to see the background. So see the background. This is the kidney, right? So this is the kidney that I'm showing you. This is hyperechoic cortex. This is the medulla. Alright, so this is the stone. How to be sure? This is very important for AIMS. Those of you are AIMS aspirants, this is something which is a potential question. Anytime I put Doppler, do you see humne Doppler dala hai? Color dala hai? What kind of a color is coming? Pura ekdam artifact aa raha hai. Lag raha hai ki ekdam color ka barsaat ho gaya. There's too much color which is emanating from the stone. Right, so this is referred to as twinkling artifact. Very nice, Ritwik. So this is the twinkling artifact which we see with stones on Doppler. Alright, so stones will show this on Doppler, wherein they show this intense amount of vascularity. Alright, it's not vessel. It's not because of the vessels per se. It's again an artifactual thing. Alright, which is not a correct representation. Usko hum artifact bolte hai. So this is twinkling artifact which all calculi show. So remember this. Anytime you are in doubt ki a stone hai ya nahi, put a Doppler box, and if you see this twinkling, it is a calculus. But why do I want to do all this? What is the investigation of choice? We'll pick up 90% of the radio opaque calculi. What is it? It's a non-contrast CT. So do you see this on the NCCT? It's a calcium wala stone which is seen so nicely. Alright, so this is NCCT that will pick up all radio opaque stones. Very nice. So the only radiolucent stone, right? We study that on X-ray. A lot of stones are radiolucent. A lot of drug stones are radiolucent. Cysteine, uric acid, all of these things can be radiolucent. But all of these things will become radio opaque on a CT. They will be visualized on CT, right? Except for Indinavir. Remember, Indinavir is the only stone that will be not visualized. That will be radiolucent on a CT also. Alright, that is why our non-contrast CT is our best bet. It's our investigation of choice. Is this clear, everybody? And what will the stone do if it passes into the ureter? If it passes into the ureter like this, it will cause upstream obstruction, and that will present as this hydronephrosis. So this is how hydronephrosis will occur because of ureteric stone. And we will see that this is the dilated pelvic calicial system that you are noting on the ultrasound. Is this clear, everybody? So this is not PUJO. Alright, so PUJO ke liye we should have seen tapering here only. But right now, if you see here, this is dilated, 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 and then yahan pe jaake we have the white stone. Alright, so this is obstruction because of the calculus. Based on ultrasound, you are right. We cannot say whether it's POJO or it's because of a distal stone. This can be any obstruction. But based on the CT, we know that this is uretric stone. Got it, everybody? So this is how stone is going to appear. Very, very important. Now, tell me the type of CT that can tell me the chemical composition. Whether it's made up of uric acid, whether it's made up of calcium oxalate, whether it's made up of cysteine. What is that type of CT that will tell me this answer? Important question for INI CT. Very good. We also use it for gout. One more clue. We also use it for gout. Good. Dual energy CT. So dual energy CT is going to tell us about the composition, right? Whether it's made up of what composition exactly, and that helps us in the management, all right? So it tells us about the parameter. And dual energy CT, remember, just as a one-liner, the principle is called material decomposition, all right? So it works on the principle of material decomposition. All right, going ahead to a few bladder image collages very, very quickly. So tell me, what is it that you are seeing in the bladder? So all of these images, you need to know what is the finding has been asked previously. So here, again in the bladder, in the dependent most position, can you see there are two hyperechoic structures which are producing posterior acoustic shadowing? Yeah, so this is bladder calculi. Now the calculi have passed into the bladder and they are producing this shadowing. What about this? What is this particular structure within the bladder? What is this here? So this is how a Foley's bulb will appear. Remember, we inflate the Foley's bulb ideally with distilled water, but in practice with normal saline. So this is that saline within the Foley's or the distilled water, and this is the bulb. This is the balloon of the Foley's, which is dilated. Jo hum wapis khich nahi sakte. Okay, so this is the Foley's bulb. What about this? When you see a hypoechoic or a solid polypoidal mass like this, this would be a polyp. Or basically, any polyp within the bladder would be what? It would be CA or TCC unless proven otherwise. So we need to do a cystoscopy and we need to biopsy this in order to rule out a transitional cell carcinoma. Do you agree? So this is our bladder mass. So you have to call this a bladder mass. Alright, very nice. What about this? What is happening to the bladder wall? Look at how thickened the bladder wall has become. Look at how it has so many such diverticulae, outpouchings. What are these called? So this is diverticula, right? So this is multiple bladder diverticulae. And when do they usually occur? So these bladder diverticulae typically occur because of any sort of obstruction. So when you have any sort of distal obstruction like BPH in an adult or posterior urethral valve in a baby, you will have these post-obstructive changes which are called as bladder diverticula, all right? So what are Hutch diverticulae, guys? Anybody has heard the term Hutch diverticulum? So Hutch diverticulum are again diverticula which are specific diverticula that arise at the insertion, alright, which occur at the insertion of the ureter. Alright, so jahan pe ureter ka insertion at the vasico-uretric junction, when you have these large diverticulae, that is referred to as the Hutch diverticulum. Okay, right. So now going ahead to the next image. What are we seeing here? So now we'll do a few signs, all right? Very quickly, let's do a few IVP signs that again you are asked very, very frequently. Why are you doing this on YouTube? Okay, what are we seeing here? So this is the bladder, right? This is the bladder, these are the two ureters, and you are seeing this indentation of the inferior margin of urinary bladder, which is the prostate. Yeah, so because of this enlarged prostate, because of this BPH, we are seeing that the ureters are having this sort of a sharp insertion. Normally they will come distally, but now they are raised because of the prostate. So this is referred to as a fish hook deformity, right? So this is called as a fish hook appearance. And what do you see? What is the investigation of choice for any prostate pathology? If I ask you whether it's malignancy or it's benign prostatic hyperplasia, remember, the best to characterize would be a MRI. All right, and that is why for PIRATS, for prostate imaging reporting and data system, what would we use? We would use MRI. All right, so remember, MRI is the only thing we use for a PIRATS scoring. So this is the axial MRI that you are seeing, which shows you this is the transitional zone and this is the peripheral zone. Tell me, where does BPH occur? Transitional zone or the peripheral zone? So TZ, transitional zone, you're going to be seeing BPH. This proliferates. When you see a mass more commonly in the peripheral zone, that is going to be carcinoma, right? So remember the location this way, centrally BPH, peripherally carcinoma. That is why malignancies, because they are so peripherally located. Do you think they're going to compress the central urethra and cause obstructive symptoms? No, they're going to cause obstructive symptoms very late. Whereas our BPH, which is occurring in the transition zone, is going to compress it and cause post-obstructive changes. And a lot of times in a coronal image, what do you see? That the prostate is reaching up to the bladder base like this, and this lobe is called uvula. So the median lobe getting enlarged is referred to as the uvula here. All right. Okay, going on to the next image. So a few more IVP images for us. Right, so one fish hook we saw. Where is the other fish hook appearance? Very quickly, so this fish hook appearance in the mid ureter, when it twists like this and upstream obstruction is there, this is called as, this is seen in what? Yeah, so this is seen in a retrocaval ureter. When you have a retrocaval ureter where the ureter anomalously passes behind the IVC. It's actually an anomaly with the IVC embryology rather than the ureter. Alright, so IVC ka galti hai, but the ureter is getting obstructed. Remember that. Okay, what about this? This everybody should know. This is drooping lily sign that you are seeing, seen with duplex collecting system. So when you have duplex collecting system, upper wala collecting system will compress the niche wala, and that will appear like it's drooping down. So this is drooping lily, D for duplex collecting system. What is this? When the ureters are medially merging, right? So when they are merging medially like this, medial deviation, this is because of something which is pulling it. Right, so when you have retroperitoneal fibrosis, right, when you have retroperitoneal fibrosis because of primary or secondary reasons, we have this maiden waist deformity. So it's basically like a maiden waist deviating medially, so retroperitoneal fibrosis. And slightly difficult, but you have one hint here. Look at the pubic symphysis. Is the pubic symphysis forming? Not really. You're having this wide separation of pubic bone. So this is suggestive of pubic diastasis. So this is suggestive of pubic diastasis here, which is seen with extrophy, right? So this is seen with bladder extrophy. And when you have the bladder placed outside, what is going to happen to the ureteric insertion? They are going to get confused ki hume kahan jana hai, right? So that is why they will form this sort of a Hurley stick appearance. All right. Investigation of choice for retrocaval ureter, again, because you want to see the arrangement of ureter and IVC, what would you do? You would go for a CT, right? You would go for a CT urography. Anytime you want to see ureter, remember guys, jab bhi ureter ko dekhna hai, pelvic calyceal system dekhna hai, CT urography will be your investigation of choice. All right. Okay. So this is basically your Hurley stick appearance. Again, four more appearances and then maybe we can stop. What are we seeing here? This is something where you have a distal dilatation of the distal end of ureter. This is called as uretroseal. This is called as uretroseal, and this appearance is called as edder head appearance. And do you notice something else here, guys? Do you notice something else? That there's also a duplex collecting system. So now when I asked you, ki ye uretroseal kaun se mein bana hoga? Would it be the upper moiety or the lower moiety? Kis mein bana hoga ye uretroseal? See, remember Wiegand-Mayer law, vowels stick together. All of you have heard it from me, vowels sticking together. So uretroseal will be with upper moiety. All the vowels wale complications go with upper. So upper moiety will undergo uretroseal formation. It will undergo obstruction. It will be ectopic, right? Kaise ectopic? It will be inferomedial to trigone. So do you understand this? All the vowels sticking together will happen with upper moiety. This lower moiety will undergo reflux. So this lower wala moiety will undergo reflux here, right? So this will undergo UR. Okay. Next one, pretty easy, pretty standard question. A lot of times asked, when you have the lower poles medially merging with one another, this is called as shaking hand calluses or a flower vase appearance seen with horseshoe. Right? Kis level pe rukega? Kis level pe fusion hoga isthmus ka? Will be at the level of L3, right? Because you have the IMA, inferior mesenteric artery, which will obstruct the ascent. Usko upar nahi chadne degi, will be blocked. So the isthmus is somewhere around the L3 level. Okay? What about this? When you have the pelvic calyceal system very splayed, giving rise to a spider leg appearance. Or you can also see a Swiss cheese appearance when you see a nephrogram. This is something which is seen with autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease. All right. And finally, when you have this appearance wherein you are seeing this paintbrush kind of an appearance, because of medullary nephrocalcinosis, there's calcification of the medullary pyramids. This is seen with medullary sponge kidney, right? So this is seen with medullary sponge kidney, wherein this is called as the paintbrush or a bouquet of flowers appearance. All right. So I think we have to stop now. I am up my time by 15 minutes, which is a lot. We can continue with the images maybe on a later date. All right. So I can do these images in the next class, but we'll definitely finish all of these images because I have some more gynae images to do. All right. Tomorrow again, we'll be meeting with MSK Radiology, guys. I hope this was useful and you revised a few very important images for your exam. Tonight, 11 o'clock, Midnight Express, we do a very rapid crash course of the entire GI surgery. All right. So GI surgery karenge and with radiology. So one very large chunk will be taken care of. So seeing you all at 11 o'clock. Okay. Thank you so much. And I'm very happy that there was no audiovisual lag today and we had no technological issues. Fingers crossed, tomorrow also the same thing should happen. Okay, guys. So thank you very much.